Now you can see it come to order.
Proceed when you're ready.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, none of the other four commissioners have appeared throughout the trial over these last couple of days.
No, sir.
You mentioned about the funding, the planning department, and that they bring in revenue, and you're aware, of course, that the sheriff's office is strictly limited by law.
Exactly.
By the revenue they can bring in, otherwise they try to become a revenue producer, they'll wind up in a bad place, right?
I'm familiar with that. Unfortunately, we have a lot of departments that are restricted.
Okay. All right. Now, these changes, well, first of all, let me ask, when you mentioned that you met with the sheriff about his budget.
Yes.
You didn't go through line item by line item with the sheriff regarding his budget, did you?
Not at that particular meeting with just him and I. We basically discussed, I think if I remember correctly, Sheriff, and correct me if I'm wrong, I asked you to put in everything that you needed, knowing that we probably couldn't fund it all, but I did, as I did all the department heads. But, you know, it was our desire to try to come up with, you know, ways to fund the needs of the department, you know. The commission and I have talked about this on numerous occasions that, you know, we don't want to run anybody's department. I don't know anything about running the sheriff's department. So what we want to do is try to help them be as efficient as they possibly can be, but obviously we have limitations.
I understand. During your testimony, you mentioned that you had met, I believe, with folks in finance and went with them line item by line item. I'm just asking, you didn't have that kind of meeting with
them? No, I did not.
Okay, all right. Now, these proposed changes that I asked Ms. Nykirk about.
Yes, sir.
It's your recollection that these came out either the night of the 10th after your proposal or the morning of the 11th, is that correct?
I think so.
And that was the first time you were aware that the email says some commissioners, but that here it says the board. That doesn't include you, right?
That does not include me, no.
So that was board of commissioners and you had...
Individual people, yes.
Well...
Wasn't the whole board, no.
All right, so then this reference here is incorrect.
It should have said some commissioners.
All right, and so the process, as I understood what your testimony was, your process was that you wanted the department heads, including the constitutional officers, to come to a public meeting so that the public could ask questions and participate, right?
Exactly.
And that was the process that you put in place and that you all followed.
That was it.
All right. And then you came to a scheduled meeting and told the department heads and the constitutional officers that they ought to come to that meeting because you were going to make your budget presentation.
Yes.
Right? But you would agree with me that these proposed changes were not discussed at all in public before this was published.
No, I don't believe it was, no.
They've asked me to turn this off after.
Okay.
I may have turned it back on.
That's fine.
Now, you and Mr. Frey have referenced a document that says estimated revenue. Do you have that where you put your hands on it?
I do. Right. Same one you have. Part of the evidence.
I just can't find it. Oh, this was your budget for all funds.
Yes.
No, I was asking you about your historical reference of estimated revenue. I thought you had some document that you said.
No, I was talking about the 2018. Oh, and I'm referring back to the CAFR reports that are done annually. I have gone back in this process and looked at what type of revenue was generated versus what type of revenue was actually proposed in those budget years. So I went back all the way to 2010 looking at what's called the audit report. Okay. And the audit report shows the proposed budget, the proposed revenue, and what actually came in versus, and all of those years, the proposed revenue was higher than what actually came in. And as I said before, luckily, the expenses were lower than proposed as well.
All right. But what my question is, you don't have a separate document?
No, sir.
Okay.
No, sir. I was just looking at the CAFRA report online, which is available to everyone.
Now, you agree, would you not, that there are more possible revenue sources for capital projects than for salaries and benefits or for?
Absolutely.
And one of those options is SPLOST.
Yes, sir. It's only going to be used for capital projects.
That's right. And in this case, we've put this up before, but you have a SPLOST that was approved in 2014, began collection in 15.
Uh-huh.
And we have in here sheriff vehicles and equipment for $3,883,000.
Yes, sir.
And you have also there fire trucks and equipment of $1,750,000, correct?
That's correct.
Being collected over 6 years. And given your background and experience, as you described to the judge, you're familiar with a CAD system, right?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, a CAD system is one of the most critical pieces of equipment for the sheriff office, as well as for the emergency services.
Yes, I mean, you have to be able to dispatch a call to be able to go.
Right, and none of the other equipment, those vehicles, is really as functional or as useful without a functioning CAD, correct?
Well, you're not going to send a piece of equipment unless you've got a CAD, but I don't know that I would agree that it's not as important.
All right. And then once you're out, particularly a sheriff's department, if they're out on the road and they've got a CAD system and they're trying to deal with a criminal situation, without that ability to communicate, a lot of the equipment they have is just not as useful.
Exactly.
Okay. And that's really the same for my firefighters. If they're not able to dispatch back and forth.
Exactly. You have to be able to talk.
All right. And as a funding option, then SPLOST money would be available for this kind of equipment, correct?
That would be, I'm obviously don't know the legalities of it, but looking at what the people voted for, I would say that would be stretching it in the gray area.
But you're not saying it couldn't be done.
I'm not saying it couldn't be, because I'm not a legal scholar to be able to tell you if that was legal or illegal, based on what the people voted on.
All right. And what the people voted on was this resolution, right?
Yep.
All right. Now, also, you're aware of lease purchase options, right?
I am. All
right. And in fact, Mr. Frey, at y'all's request, had sent a opinion over to y'all about acquiring a fire engine. And that was October 4, 2017, right?
That's correct.
After you approved the budget.
Uh-huh.
And he tells you, we can go through it, it's an exhibit that we've admitted,
uh-huh.
But he tells you that lease purchase is certainly available through ACCG for the SPLOST acquisition of a fire engine, right?
Yes.
All right. And are you aware of whether a lease purchase option is also available, whether you use SPLOST funds or general fund?
Yes.
Okay. And if the lease purchase is affected, then the amount set aside for the CAD would be reduced, at least for the year 2018.
Well, I mean, unless you were going to use that as part of the way of paying it back.
Yes, sir. If you were going to use, regardless of whether it's SPLOST funds, general funds, by entering into a lease purchase, you would necessarily free up some of that $260,000 to go back towards salaries.
Well, you could if you weren't going to use it as a funding mechanism to pay back the loan.
Okay, but then
you got to have a philosophy of how you're going to pay that loan back.
All right, and in this case, the funding philosophy was to set $260,000 aside and not use it at all in 18, correct?
Correct.
And then to fund the balance in 2019.
That's correct.
Correct?
That's correct.
All right, so that was already the concept proposed by the Board of Commissioners, was to use the general fund money over 2 years.
Yes.
All right. So lease purchase is certainly an option for this CAD system, and that lease purchase amount in all likelihood would be substantially less than $260,000 for 1 year.
For 1 year?
Yes, sir.
Depending on what the total cost for the system would be?
Yes, sir. And the numbers expired, but it was $520,000 under the...
Yeah, that was the quote that the sheriff got, yes.
Right.
$520,000.
Which is now expired, correct?
I would imagine so, yes.
All right. So again, my question is, by utilizing the lease purchase option, which Mr. Frey acknowledges is a valid option.
It is.
Okay. Then you, whether you used SPLOST money or general fund money or any combination thereof, you could reduce that $260,000 that you're setting aside and not using at all in 18.
You could if you weren't going to use that as your payback mechanism.
And I don't understand the second part. If you weren't going to use it as your payback mechanism.
Well, in other words, if you borrow $520,000, you have to have some method of paying it back.
Yes.
You've got to know where it's going to come from.
Yes, sir.
So right. What the board did was, they and you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I think in our discussions with the sheriff, it was our understanding that the CAD system would definitely need to be replaced by 2019. And I know you had some documentation in your paperwork that said that some other states had already put into place a rule or a law that said that they needed to get up to this next generation system that you were asking for by a certain time. Georgia was not one of those at this particular time that had said that you had to do it by a specific date, but that they could be, that could be something that the legislature would authorize.
What does that have to do with the payback mechanism?
Well, I mean, I don't understand why you don't understand what I'm saying, because you have to, no matter if you borrow money, you have to pay it back.
All right, and that's all I'm asking. So if we did a lease purchase, what would the 1 year, do you agree that the 1 year payment on that lease purchase would be less than 260?
Depending on how many years you leased it for.
All right, and so you could negotiate that, correct?
You could.
All right. And in the meantime, could also seek grant funds to contribute toward that payment.
Absolutely. And we encourage our department heads and elected officials to go after all the grants.
And so you acknowledge that, at least for personnel purposes, you can't use SPLOST money, right?
That's correct.
And obviously, lease purchase money is not available. In other words, that's not
available. It's not the pathway by which to go, because it's a forever cost.
And that's what I'm saying. So when you get to individuals, you don't have those same funding options that you have with a capital item.
That's true.
All right. Now, you were mentioning that it's a forever cost, and as an answer just now. When you provided a response about hiring the 9 employees for the fire department, you mentioned to them that they would only be employed for 3 years.
Yes.
That was a possibility.
That was a possibility.
All right. And in Dawson County, we don't have a civil service system, right?
Nope.
And the only contract we have with any employee is with the county manager, correct?
All of our employees are at will, to my knowledge.
All right. So any employee is really not guaranteed employment for any particular length of time.
No.
All right.
They don't do their job, they're not, no.
Right, but for any reason, since
yeah.
At will, you could say, and just as you pointed out, if funding wasn't available for any reason in the future, then that position may not be available. So that's really true for all employees.
It is, and that's the department level and the elected official level. They'd have to make that decision on their own.
Right. But when this budget was approved, approximately $150,000 came out of fund balance to fund those positions in the fire department.
Yes, that was part of the fund balance total that was used to balance the budget.
Okay. But that's when, that's how you budgeted for these specific positions was to come out of fund balance?
Yes, as well as the other $1.something million that would be used for whatever.
And then, at the end of each year, if there's money left over in a budget, such as in the sheriff's department budget, that's put back into the fund balance as well.
That's correct. That's county policy.
All right. And so over the years, when there's certain items, equipment, whatever it may be, that the sheriff's office has left over, they put that back in fund balance, correct?
They have done that in the past, yes.
Right. Now, you also mentioned in your testimony that the sheriff directs payment as long as it's within his budget.
Yes, sir.
And in 2016, the sheriff had officers who he wanted to pay for forfeited leave under his policy.
Yes, sir.
Personnel policy. And that's still not been paid, even though he directed that it be paid, right?
I don't know that he officially ever directed finance to pay them and sent any timesheets over in reference to that, but he was told that if he had leftover money to pay them.
Right. And by then, the money had already, the county took position, it had already transferred from his control to a fund balance.
What we told him was to use 2017 leftover money to pay them because that transition had already took place.
And, but you would not allow him to use what was left over from 16.
Well, that's correct according to the policy, yes.
Right, but it's his policy that controls, right?
That would have been Sheriff Carlisle's policy at that particular time.
Right. And then he took over January 1, 2017.
Yes.
And Sheriff Carlisle likewise approved that payment for those deputies who had forfeited leave, didn't he?
Don't know if I've seen any documentation to that, no.
But we don't know one way or the other.
No, I don't know that he did because, like I said, I don't remember anybody ever being told by finance or HR that documentation, excuse me, had been turned in authorizing that payment.
All right.
There wasn't talk of it, and the only thing I can speak to is 2017 because I've been chairman since January 1st, 2017, and Sheriff Johnson was advised in a public meeting, if he had leftover 2017 money and he wanted to pay those officers for their lost leave time in 16, to do that with the money that he had left over in 2017, because he told us that he was going to have leftover 17 money.
All right, so are you saying that was said at one of his budget?
It was said I don't remember if it was one of the, exactly which meeting it was, but we did talk about it.
And there was also a meeting, first of all of the funds or all of the expenses for any department, whether it's the sheriff's department or anybody else, some of those come in January of the year following when the liability or the bill was incurred. In other words, you'll have items that are done in December, but you don't get the bill until January. Is that correct?
That is correct.
All right. And so the 16 amount budgeted would include those items that you just don't get the bill for until sometime in January.
Yes.
All right. So then the sheriff taking over in January 1 of 2017 would still be entitled to control events that occurred in 2016 under his policies.
Had he turned it in, yes.
All right. So then it's up to the sheriff to turn something in writing to say, pay this.
To my knowledge, it would be, yes.
And whether he did that, you don't know whether he did that.
I have no idea.
All right. So the statement that items within the sheriff's budget will be paid as directed by Sheriff Johnson just needs to include directed in writing by Sheriff Johnson or his staff, correct?
Turned in some form of a bill or something coming from him that says he wants it paid, yes, because right. He can spend his money. I know the county has a, I think there's a cutoff date for bills that come in after December 31st. I think it's sometime the 1st of February. And I'm sure he's familiar with that date. I'm not sure exactly what it is. I think it's February 1st or somewhere in that range. But there's always, like I said, if you have a bill that you created on December the 29th, it may not come in until January 15th.
And so items being turned in would be things like the turning in for the deputies to be paid that the sheriff would sign off on and approve.
Yes.
All right. Now, the salary study that you referenced, that there was a 105% turnover.
Yes, sir.
The author of that salary study did not attribute the entire turnover solely to salary, correct?
No, sir. Other reasons. There were, you know, multiple reasons, obviously, for turnover. People were fired, they were, you know, people got better jobs, obviously. People may not like their boss.
And finally, I put up the slide several times, but the number comparison you used when you made your budget presentation, that was based upon information given to you by the finance department?
Yes. We worked in conjunction to come up with a number, yeah.
That's what I'm saying, but the initial number to use for the comparison came from their records that they provided to you.
Yes.
I mean, okay. All right.
But I was aware of that it was 2017 original, yes.
All right. And you mentioned that the other commissioners added this SRO position within these changes.
They did.
And they also, you mentioned that that's funded in part by the school district, correct?
That is correct.
All right. And then the board deemed fit to remove $15,000 for SWAT equipment to fund that SRO position as written within those changes, right?
They did.
All right.
Thank you. Redirect.
Just for clarification, you referred to the CAFR.
Well, that's the audit report.
That's the comprehensive annual finance report that is
online.
And have exhibit R3. And is online.
All the way back for several years, yes.
Whatever you don't use in 2018, assuming some of it was used to pay for the lease option purchase approach to a CAD system, whatever you don't use of that $260,000 that's been set aside as capital and would under the current plan roll over into the next year's budget, the 2019 budget, to be matched by an anticipated additional $260,000 in capital. If instead you did the lease option, whatever you don't use to pay in the current year on that lease option, either would be available for something else in the current year.
Correct.
Or could be rolled over into the next year, that balance of it, to pay for the lease option in the following year.
That is correct.
And potentially into other years.
That's correct. The board would have discretion of how they would want to use that. They could either buy other capital projects that were not considered or funded, or they could consider to move it wherever they, you know, so desire. They would have that authority.
So if you were to negotiate a lease option purchase of the CAD system that was one that required $260,000 in payment that first year, obviously you'd be using it all.
Exactly.
Year. if it extends over enough years, then there would be that many payments of whatever the number turns out to be made in the future.
That would be correct.
So that money could be rolled over for that purpose.
It could be.
I just didn't want it to be left hanging out there that it could, it would automatically go or be available for something else. Lease purchase option is something that I take it there's no objection to doing, it just, it was not brought up. Is that correct?
Don't remember it being brought up. Now, we have used it in the past, yes, but I'm not familiar whether it was brought up in reference to that or not.
So with the given budget that you already have, that's a potential way to approach it.
Yes.
You don't have to do a new budget.
I wouldn't think so. I mean, I'm not sure exactly about all the financial rules associated with it, but I wouldn't think so.
I think that's all I have.
Recross?
Yes, sir. If you give me just a minute, please.
Chairman, I'm going to represent to you this attached to our petition, which is a letter dated September 7, 2017. I'll show you page 3 of that letter.
Okay.
Sheriff remains willing to work with the county to resolve this matter. The $260,000 proposed to be set aside for 2018 should be eschewed. The CAD system serves the sheriff's office and other public safety functions, qualifies as a SPLOST expenditure, and should be programmed. And then this 260 could then be added to the sheriff's budget to reduce the shortfall. So that information was provided to the commission as part of the process that has been described. Is that correct?
Yeah, that was as a potential SPLOST expenditure, yes.
Okay. And then in the meetings, the discussion, or in the various discussions that we had, the meetings also included the option of lease purchase.
I'm not sure. I don't remember exactly whether we discussed lease purchase or not, but we could have.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Another further, y'all.
Okay. You can come down.
Thank you.
And we rest.
All right. Any rebuttal?
No, thank you.
We discussed in chambers before we started. Procedurally, write a supplemental brief by way of argument law or whatever form and whatever length or brevity you wanted to make it. And in lieu of or in addition to argument here, and also a proposed order. Where do we stand now? Do you still want to make argument here, Mr. Holmes?
I would request that, Judge, but I'm more interested in the court's focus of where you see any particular issue or whether it's you still want us to address it.
I'm inclined to leave it open to you because, I mean, I don't know the parties involved. I don't know the history of any issues. I don't know the particulars historically or very much currently of the finances of the county and all those kinds of things. And you're in a better position to know that than I am and to point that out if you think it's helpful to your case. I guess one of the things in argument today it would be of interest to me is the at least a quick summary of what you contend to be the legal standards we operate under here. What's the burden of of each party here. And I guess what's the limitations on what the court can do here? And with respect to what the county has failed to do that would support a mandamus order, now what is it they've not done that they should have done, or that the sheriff has asked for legitimately that they should have done and haven't done? I mean, that's. It seems to me that's sort of the issue we're going to be looking at here to resolve about it.
I agree.
Okay. All right. You want a few minutes or take 10 minutes before we commence arguments? Are you ready?
I'm ready. I was just going to conclude, Your Honor.
All right. Mr. Frey?
I'm ready to respond to anything he may say, and certainly would still.
Well, he's got an opening and closing, and I believe he's waving opening.
I will. I'll wave open.
Okay.
I understand your points, Judge.
Your Honor, I think that.
And you address anything you want to supplement with.
And I certainly would appreciate that opportunity to do that. And I'll keep it where you can stick to the points you just raised for this oral response here. The standard is, I'd say there are a couple of standards in operation here, several standards. The sheriff has. As he just said, the duty to carry out the statutory duties of his constitutional office, essentially to be the chief law enforcement officer of the county, and to do the things that he's done through the various divisions that have been represented in testimony here. He has those duties. The county, on the other hand, has the duty to provide in a reasonable way a budget as best they can, as within the revenue that's available to them, that in an overall sense responds to his needs, even though, just like every other constitutional officer and other department, every other function, there may not be enough money to give him to do everything he would like to do, or to do it in the way he feels like would be best. I don't think that there's a burden on the county legally to give something to him just because he comes to them with a request or something that's not off the wall. Frankly, I think that what you have heard is probably pretty typical of the kind of requests and justifications that were made across the board by the various departments and agencies and officials. They were not outlandish in any way. The county would like to no doubt have done more, but they were constrained by the available revenue. The burden is on them to act reasonably in the way they make the decisions about how to assign that available revenue. And the standard is quite simply abuse of that discretion. They have the discretion to set the budget. He does have discretion to move money around within his available budget that has been provided to him. And he's aware of that. He's exercised that discretion and that authority in this past year. But that said, he does not have the discretion to set his own budget. That burden is on the county, that responsibility, and ultimately they are stewards of the funds that the public entrusts to them, in the sense of not only what's in the bank, but in the approach they take to finding revenue sources and to determining things such as millage rate. They can't determine how much money comes in from loss or spoils. They can make projections, and they've given you an idea of how they made those projections. But they have to balance out the available revenues with those legitimate needs across the board. The sheriff is just one moving piece, albeit the biggest piece, the greatest piece, and I would submit has been given due regard by the commission in meeting their burden of providing funding to him in response to his request. They have given priority to public safety, more so to the sheriff's office than to the fire, EMS, and EMA public safety departments. But collectively, that's nearly half of their budget, and the sheriff has the biggest part of it. So it shows the emphasis that they put on the sheriff, his function, his duties, and his request. I think they've acted entirely in good faith. I think it's obvious that they've been very diligent in their approach to this year's budget and have made an effort to be thorough. They have tried to gather as much information as they could. They've tried to involve departments, officials, and agencies in as much input, including appearances before the board, in a greater degree of transparency, in a greater degree of participation and involvement across the board, and even in the form of an earlier start, as described. So I think that there's certainly no reason to think there's been an abuse of discretion, certainly nothing that would be a basis for mandamus in the sense of an order to give more money to the sheriff for 2018. They will certainly be, as they have said, revisiting during the course of the year what to do in terms of possibly amending the 2018 budget. And given where we are in the year, it won't be long before they will already be working with him towards trying to develop a 2019 budget. That process will be starting soon. I think that mandamus is only available in the case of a clear legal right, and I don't think he's shown any clear legal right to anything more than what they have given him. The difficult aspect of this is if you were to try to fashion a remedy here, the courts are limited in what they can do. Obviously, the courts are not in a position to police line items of budget allocations and appropriations. And the case law, I think Mr. Homans would agree, does not put that burden on you. So the most that would be doing would be done with a mandamus in any event would be something that they are already going to be doing in the revisiting of the budget during the course of this year for 2018. But as I say, already looking forward to the prospect of working with him towards the fiscal year 2019 budget that's coming up. I think the basic need for it, the basic way to approach fashioning an order or remedy in terms of mandamus, not only is it unnecessary and unjustified, I think it would be a very difficult thing to put it into terms that could be employed by these parties short of what they're going to be doing anyway. With that, I'll
leave it to Mr. Homans.
Thank you, sir.
Judge, as to your question, the burden of proof is a civil case. It's by preponderance of the evidence, and what we have to establish is whether the sheriff has shown here a legal right to the relief sought, which is the mandamus, to require adequate funding of the sheriff's office to permit the sheriff to perform his duties of enforcing the law and preserving the peace. What needs to be understood here is that the sheriff is an elected constitutional officer. And so under the process, under the Saber decision and what we put in the trial brief, is that he is to submit a budget that he says is necessary for him to perform his duties. The law does grant the commission, the county commission, the authority to cut that budget. But in the course of making those cuts, the sheriff still must be permitted to enforce the law and preserve the peace. And so as to the abuse of discretion standard arises as to whether the Board of Commissioners abused their discretion in the cuts they made to the budget he proposed, that is the sheriff proposed, that still permit him to perform his constitutional and statutory obligations. So I understand how the county's going about that, but I submit it misses the mark because the county's saying, well, here's where they were in the past. But as to a reason for cutting the budget proposed by the sheriff, they've really not presented any evidence. And for that reason, other than they say we don't have sufficient revenue, and that we come back to that's what we would say in the writ, or that the writ would be ordered by the court, is that Board of Commissioners, I'm entering this writ of mandamus requiring you to adequately fund the sheriff's office, is in essence what it would be. It's not your determination as to what that adequate funding is. The law clearly makes that a legislative function, so it would go back to the Board of Commissioners. That's the focus of most of the cases. We went into some of the detail that we went into during this trial because the standard is abuse of discretion. So the abuse of discretion is not adequately funding, but we took it one step further, Judge, actually maybe several steps further. And as we've shown here, the commission not only abused their discretion by not adequately funding, but they didn't even adequately present their options. I want to say to Chairman Thurmond that the sheriff and his staff and I couldn't appreciate more him being here. But I think it ought to speak volumes that no other commissioner even sat through to hear what it is that is the concern for the sheriff's obligation to enforce the law and preserve the peace. When you heard those witnesses, it's not a question of if something terrible is going to occur in Dawson County because our sheriff's department is not adequately staffed. It's a question of when. We've had a couple of incidents where our deputies have been injured. It's going to continue to happen. And that's what these deputies came in here and told you. We're really 22 people short, we're now 26 people short. And the sheriff, out of all good faith, came in with this budget and said, okay, if you will give me the 10 positions that I seek, then we'll keep working toward the 139 that Mr. Hallsworth says he needs, and if you heard the testimony of the officers, the captains and the lieutenant who was here and the sheriff, that's really what they need. But we had added 3 through the 17 budget, and as long as we see some progress toward filling this void to 2015 and given the growth, the explosive growth, particularly on the commercial retail that was testified to by Ms. Nyker, that's drawing in a whole population or a whole lot of population other than a residential population, that puts the burden on the sheriff's office. I agree with what the chairman's saying. Who's that going to impact? Planning. And it's an abuse of discretion because they gave. What we're trying to show is you meet those needs, commissioners. You give them 2 people in 17.
You get 9 to the fire department, they're going to be impacted by this type of growth. But to say to the sheriff's office, you stay the same. And they came in saying that we didn't add patrol was one of the public statements that was made. That's not what you asked for. And that just wasn't true. That's the abuse of discretion, is nobody went to the sheriff and said, well, what are these positions? What do we need? And had that been done, then they would see that there are needs here. Is he willing to work with them? Yes. In fact, that's why we try to propose solutions. That's why my letters are there. Everybody says you have more options with capital than you do with people. All right, we'll live with that. We'll live with that. We understand your limits that you have because you only have so much revenue. We understand. So let's go to the capital project side of that and let's work together to find a way to fund these capital projects in a way that won't exhaust an entire amount. That $260,000 is why I kept coming back to it. With these critical needs, why would you take that money and just set it on the sideline? That would fund 2, 3, or more several positions for the sheriff's office, and we could start working together. If you'll unfreeze these positions, or some of them, then we can move forward, but they won't. And that's the abuse of discretion, is not understanding their options. We know they didn't understand their options, because even the information they reported stated that they gave him a more an increased budget that he doesn't have, and said he had control over the SPLOST money that we know he doesn't have control over. That's set by the voters, and we'll work with it. I don't see that it is a stretch under the SPLOST law, Your Honor, and I'll just put it in my brief rather than standing here talking to you about it. But it's a clear SPLOST item. If you've got a sheriff's vehicle and equipment and a fire truck and equipment, how in the world CAD can't be considered part of that equipment is unknown. And the abuse of discretion is to come in here and say, well, we raised your SPLOST budget for the year, when under the SPLOST, he should be getting $600,000 a year if you're going to do it that way. And really, the SPLOST money is going to come in more than the $46 million. We ought to recalculate that SPLOST. We're willing to work with them, however. That's the abuse of discretion, is to say, I said no, and therefore it's no. And instead of meeting with us, commissioners got together in private and modified this budget and marshaled it forward. But for us, we go to a public meeting and get asked about 8-month-old contracts that have already been paid. So it doesn't appear that there's any willingness to have dialogue. There wasn't any dialogue in those meetings. We came there to hear speeches. The option of saying, you've got an entire salary amount, that's something that the county's hinted at. Okay, you've got an overall budget. So if you want more people, then you just hire those people with your overall budget. What does that mean, Judge? That means they want them to go into the sheriff's office and say, okay, everybody's got to take a salary cut so that we can fund these other positions. You know what we're going to have then? We're going to have a drop in the number of people that are within the sheriff's office, and we're going to be in a more drastic and dire need than as we stand here today. We submit that the evidence here shows the abuse of discretion by not properly funding the sheriff's office, but more than that, we show it's abuse of discretion because they refused the Board of Commissioners as a whole, not the chairman, but the Board of Commissioners as a whole absolutely refused to consider viable options to meet the needs of the sheriff's office, or at least start meeting the needs of the sheriff's department, so that he can do his job that he was elected to do, to enforce the law, preserve the peace, and prevent a tragedy from occurring. Thank you.
Well, let me say, first off, I think it was a well-tried case on both sides. And let me also say, I think Dawson County is fortunate to have elected officials we've got here with the sheriff and the chairman. Obviously both bright and competent and don't mind working, which is not always the case of public officials, so I think Dawson County is fortunate. And the issues here, obviously, they're serious issues, but I think anybody can recognize, you don't have to be a lawyer, a judge, or an elected official of any kind. look at the instances, importance, I guess, of the kind of people you got, being able to pay them decent pay is, I mean, given the times we live in, politically and societal, I guess, the prospects of having a deputy stop a car in the middle of the night on a back road somewhere, not having a clue who's going to come out, whether they're going to have a weapon or not, or what kind of problems you got, what kind of threats you got. I mean, that's kind of, I guess, these days, routine stuff in police work, unfortunately. And things like the being able to provide sufficient courtroom security is, everybody knows, I suspect, about folks in the county's experience with a judge and court reporter shot dead in the courtroom, a deputy shot dead in the courthouse, and a federal agent shot dead thereafter. I mean, those are things that happen. And the less competent people you've got, the less security you've got, the more likely those kind of things happen, which doesn't make anybody happy. So, and on the other hand, I think obviously you got county commissioners elected to run the county government. That includes paying attention to how you spend money and do it. You spend it in public funds, and it's not something that's not a frivolous kind of action. The proposed budgets and authorized expenditures, and is an obligation, obviously, to look critically at proposed budgets of department heads and all that sort of thing. It goes with it. They're not doing a job if they don't. So I think those are issues, and I don't find, and it doesn't appear to me as capricious or arbitrary kind of acts either way, but the question is, based on the evidence, apply the law here, what's the result? And that, I don't know at this point. I'm going to sit down and take a look, review the evidence, and I'll take a look at the supplement you submit, and see what appears to be, in my judgment, the appropriate order in doing that. And let me just say one other thing, I don't know to what extent there have been efforts to resolve the case, but it seems to me there ought to be a face-to-face, sincere sit-down here between the parties to see if there's some middle ground here. And I don't know if there is or not, but it seems to me this kind of case might very well find some middle ground. I mean, obviously the county's not loaded up with excess money to grant every authorized expenditures, whatever anybody wants, including the sheriff. On the other hand, you've got people who've got obvious needs that are important to the community, then that's something that ought to be addressed and give us consideration as well. But it's some of the considerations seem to me is no matter what the order is, it comes out of this case by way of the trial, you've got a good likelihood, I suppose, that there'll be an appeal by the person who, the party that doesn't get what it wants, in which case it's another delay, more attorney's fees and time that comes with an appeal. And maybe it's not resolved before the next budget's addressed, and got the same issue continuing on into the next budget. So it's just all, it seems to me, some time-wise, money-wise, and general ability to function-wise for the county and for the sheriff's department sitting down and taking a look at reaching some kind of accommodation to each other, and maybe some middle ground to resolve this and put it to rest and go forward. Now, I don't know if they can do that or not. I guess lawyers always ready to say, okay, you want an appeal? You want another round of it? You know, here's my fee. I need some money. And that goes with it, and as far as it wouldn't do it, then the courts are there, and we've all seen cases that go on and up and down the credit courts and all that sort of thing. we'll see if they'll be in. It seems to me with the parties we've got here and the competence of the parties here, that the experience of the parties here, that there ought to be some middle ground to find something that fundamentally works. May not make everybody totally happy, but can it would fundamentally work. And you know what the budgets are, you know what the needs are, and all those kinds of things. So that'd be a matter of you sitting down and deciding if you can. And if you can't, then I'll do my job, which is to draft an order, assign an order, whatever I deem appropriate. And at that point, if we have unhappy folks, then the appellate courts await. Anything else from the petitioner?
Judge, just a timeline. What kind of timeline?
What do you want?
A week, 10 days, something like that.
Mr. Bryant?
I'd say 10 days, particularly if we're going to be able to follow up on your suggestion that you just made. I think that we can be diligent about both.
That's mad at me. Whatever works for you, tell me what it is.
10 days.
10 days.
All right. 10 days, well.
That'll probably fall on the weekend. We lose track of time in New York.
All right, so. What does 10 days come to? Where is that?
Be Saturday.
10 business days.
10 business days.
All right, so that's two for the rest of this week. That is 7, 8, 9, 10. Close of business Thursday, February the 15th. How about that?
Yes,
sir. Honor before February 15th. Is that satisfactory?
Yes, sir. We'll just explain that while we're working on Valentine's Day.
Don't put it out, dude.
Okay.
We stand adjourned.
Thank you.
Court is going to have the exhibits. Good to see everybody here. You got a good group of folks here all the way around. We're good to meet you.
We don't have to go anywhere right now. we're not at 5 o'clock and all that.
Yeah.
All right, I'm gonna leave this right here.